blessed, of the blessed assurance. I am not a lucky man, I am a blessed man. Is there not here a prophet? Is there not here a man who can romance God?
Hey.
I said, hey. Can I prophesy this?
Prophesy!
Your door has been opened.
Amen.
I said, your door has been opened.
Amen.
I speak at the servant of God that your door.
Amen.
I've come to announce you, ladies and gentlemen, that the message of God will begin to blow upon somebody today. God has a plan for your life and make you the champion that God Almighty has ordained for you to be.
Just lift up your right hand with me and close your eyes for a word of prayer. Father, we thank you once again for this morning and for another opportunity even to be blessed by you. We ask Spirit Divine that touch our lives within this service and release us as agent of transformations. We give you glory. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Oh, I said amen.
Amen.
I want to welcome each and everyone to Spirit Life Revival Ministries, the prophetic city. Especially those who are worshiping with us for the first time. I'm God's servant, Prophet Bernard L. Bernard Nelson Ishan. I wanted to look into the eyes of the person sitting beside you and tell the person, I'm glad I'm sitting beside you. Or tell the next person, I'm glad I'm sitting beside you. Ask the person, aren't you glad you are sitting beside me? Or tell the person, be glad because it could be I'm your boss. Or tell somebody, be careful how you treat me. Tell the next person, be careful how you treat me, because you may need me someday. Or tell somebody, be careful how you treat me, because it could be I'm your in-law. I want to bless God once again for this Sunday morning. It has been 16 years of being born again and walking with God, preaching and teaching the word of God, 9 years of Bernard Nelson Scholarship Scheme, 9 years of Bernard Nelson Ministries, and 9 years of full-time prophetic ministries. 7 years of pastoring this church, and God has been faithful. Almost every year, the month of May is dedicated to celebrate great, great men of God across the globe, and also to celebrate my birthday and what the Lord is doing through me. God has blessed us this morning with a father. The man of God we are about to listen to is an internationally recognized life coach and a leadership architect. He's a respected speaker and author on issues related to leadership, development, and living a life of excellence. A noted educator and the president of the Institute of Leadership Excellence and Development. He has personally mentored, consulted for, and coached a wide array of leaders in churches, businesses, and government. He's the founder and the senior pastor of All Nations Church in Atlanta, Georgia, and general overseer of Living Springs International Fellowship Incorporated, where he has an apostolic oversight over several churches and organizations across the globe. Bishop Frank Ofusu Appiah and his wife, Mrs. Mary Ofusu Appiah, have 4 children and live in Atlanta, Georgia. Church, it's a great honor for us to host this great man of God. We don't have the capacity even to bring him, but grace have located us this morning. Bible said we should give honor to those that honor is due with a mighty shout and a clap offering. Help me welcome our father, Bishop Frank.
What are you turning to wine? Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. Not like you. Into the darkness we say. Into the darkness we shine. Out of the ashes. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. Nobody like the Lord. Not like you. Our God is great, oh so. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. Lord, you are higher than me. Father, our God is healer. Our sovereign power. Our God. Our God. Our God is greater. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. Lord, you are higher than me. Father, our God is healer. Our sovereign power. Our God. And if our God is for us, and if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is in us, then who could stand against us? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then who could stand against us?
You to sit down. That's better. That's better. That's better. Standing is a statement that you are not paralyzed. The ability to stand is an indication that there are many things right with you. So tell somebody, I am still standing. Do you know how many things conspired to not let you stand up this morning? And how many obituaries were written for you in the spirit? But somehow you defied the expectation of the enemy. I don't know about you, but I think about the many thousands of people who went to bed last night. Some even set the alarm clock to wake them up. The alarm clock went off okay, but their bodies never responded. So if you are alive this morning and you can hear me and see me and stand, then the Bible says, clap your hands, all ye people. Clap your hands. All ye people. Clap your hands, all ye people. I don't think God will be offended if we added a shout to our clap. Amen. Please be seated. Like somebody said, he said, be seated on the head of the devil. Well, it's a pleasure to be here today. Several years ago, I'd been traveling a lot and I was very tired. I think I'd been to Australia, New Zealand. I mean, I'd been tired and I had come back to the city of London and I was preaching in another meeting. And you know, when you're a preacher, when you go to places, sometimes there are some things you say automatically, like, oh, I'm happy to be here. And that particular day, I was so tired. I didn't want to be at where I was. So when I was introduced, my first statement was, oh, I'm happy to be here. And I felt the Spirit of the Lord asking me, are you really sure you are happy to be here? But this morning, I'm happy to be here. Amen. I'm happy to be here. And I want to thank Prophet Bernard L. Bernard Nelson Nation, you know, for this opportunity given to me to be here amongst you. I could have been in 1,000 places, but I chose to be here because I want to be here. And I have heard a few good things, a lot of good things, I beg your pardon, about this great man that God is raising and using. And somehow God caused our paths to cross a couple of days ago. I got to see him. And I thank God for your life. And one of the things I realize is that he's a wise man. And wait. I'll give you a lot of opportunity to clap. Don't worry, we'll be getting to some things. And one of the reasons why I say that is that in the few minutes that he had with me, he had asked me so many questions. The problem and the major challenge with a lot of you, the young generation, is that you are not asking questions. And so the older generation is dying and taking away a lot of things with them because nobody is making a demand on them. And by the way, nobody will answer a question you haven't asked. So he asked me a lot of questions. He drew a lot of things. And I said, this is a man who is going somewhere. And I'm so glad that in 7 years, 9 years, and his short life yet, because he's going to live for a very long time, he's done this amazing thing. I want us to rise and put our hands together for the prophet. Put your hands together for him. God bless you. Oh, yes. Let's do it well. Let's do it well. Let's do it well. Let's do it well. You may be seated. God bless you. And I want to acknowledge the presence of some of my children here, all the way from the city of Atlanta. George and Ade, please wave your hands or stand. Let's acknowledge you. Amen. Very amazing family couple. God bless you. God bless you. All the way from Atlanta. They live in Ghana here at the cutting edge of what God is doing through them in the nations. One of the things you've got to understand is that ministry is not only preaching. Ministry is everywhere. And you carry ministry with you everywhere. And I brought some of my family members. Raise your hands up. Let's welcome you. Amen. So let's get into some word. I know you are checking me out. You don't know me. I'm also checking you out. I don't know you. I don't like you yet because you don't like me yet. But I think after we finish, we'll like each other. Is that okay? Is that a deal? Turn in your Bibles to 1 Samuel chapter 17, if you have a Bible, that is. 1 Samuel chapter 17. And by the way, I brought a few of my material. I think let me do this and get it out of the way. I don't waste too much time on that. But I've written several books. I think these are what is left. I think they may have it somewhere. This is my first book that I wrote, Journey into Destiny. For me, it's my most favorite book. Prophet, somebody asked me the other day how long it took me to write this book. And I said, my whole life. A lot of people don't break through in life, not because they lack talent or anointing or goodwill, but because they lack strategies in life. I gave 10 strategies for effective living. You can be anointed and be an anointed fool. You can be prayerful and be a prayerful fool. The Bible says by wisdom a house is built. And many times if you don't learn wisdom from other people, you learn wisdom from your mistakes. In fact, sometimes you don't even learn from your mistakes. And I put together this book for you, just for you. If you will read it, and if it doesn't change you, you can have your money back. But it's okay, it's for you. Apart from the prophet, whose birthday is today? Anybody's birthday today? You? Today? Come for this. Happy birthday to you. I hope you brought a birthday gift for the prophet. I hope you brought a birthday gift for your prophet. You have it already. You better. Happy birthday to you. God bless you. One of the greatest weapons the enemy has is the weapon of distraction. Is it your birthday too? Are you a twin with the prophet? Oh, you look like him. Are you a prophet too? Hey. Why? So, what's your name? Benedict. L. Benedict. I think I'll change the book and give you a new one. This is I Believe I Can Fly. Listen, you are not a turkey, you are an eagle. And I use the eagle as a metaphor to describe the eagle that is on the inside of you. Apostle Benedict, happy birthday to you. I have this one called Shake It Off. Shake it off. Shake it off. When the snake bit Paul, he shook the snake into the fire. It's for those who are focused. This book is Our hidden thing. Everybody has it, but nobody talks about it, and I won't tell you until you buy the book. So buy it, and it will do you well. Whose wedding anniversary is today? Anybody whose wedding anniversary is today? That is if you are married. Not by faith. I'll be preaching in a short while. I don't preach long. Normally by 4 hours, I should be done, so don't worry. Prophet, I think I'm going to enjoy your church. I'm going to enjoy your church. We're going to have fun. Why? Is it your anniversary? So why did you stand up? Nobody got up. You're a wise man. Take it. I'm thinking about the last one. What are you the choir?
Yes.
No, she stood up first. She stood up first. You come. But she stood up first. Then let me bless you, okay? Okay, 1 Samuel chapter 17. I'm going to do this. Let's do this very quickly. It's a long passage, but I want to believe that. How many of you don't know the story of David and Goliath? You don't know the story. You've never heard it before. David and Goliath. Or depending on where you come from, David and Goliath. Anybody? So you all know the story. Okay. In 1 Samuel chapter 17, it talks about the story of David and Goliath. Goliath was a national challenge. And David confronted that giant and amazing things happened. The Bible says in verse number 1 that the Philistines gathered their armies together to battle. They were gathered at Succoth, which belonged to Judah. They encamped between Succoth and Azekah in Ephes Damin, and Saul and the men of Israel were gathered together. They encamped in the valley of Elah and drew up in battle array against the Philistines. The Philistines stood on a mountain on one side, and Israel stood on the mountain on the other side with the valley in between. And a champion went out from the camp of the Philistines named Goliath from Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. He had a bronze helmet on his head, and he was armed with a coat of mail. And the weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of bronze, and he had a bronze armor on his legs and bronze javelin between his shoulders. And it goes on and on and on and on. And let's jump to verse number 8. He stood and cried out to the armies of Israel and said to them, "Why have you come up to line up for battle? Am I not a Philistine, and you the servants of Saul? Choose a man for yourselves, and let him come down to me. If he's able to fight with me and kill me, then we will be your servants. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then you shall be our servants and servers." And the Philistines, of course, he defied the armies of Israel, then his brothers, blah, blah, blah. Let's go down to verse 23. As he talked with them, the champion, the Philistine of Gath, Goliath by name, coming out from the armies of the Philistines, and he spoke according to the same words. So David heard them, and all the men of Israel, when they saw the man, fled from him and were dreadfully afraid. So the men of Israel said, "Have you seen this man who has come up? Surely he has come up to defy Israel. It shall be that the man who kills him, the king will enrich with great riches, and will give him his daughter and give him his father's house exemption from taxes in Israel." Then David spoke to the men who stood by him, saying, "What shall be done for the man who kills this Philistine and takes away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?" And the people answered him in this manner, saying, "So it shall it be done for him, for the man who kills him." Now Eliab, his oldest brother, heard when he spoke to the men, and Eliab's anger was aroused against David, and he said, "Why did you come down here? With whom have you left those few sheep in the wilderness? I know your pride and the insolence of your heart, for you have come down to see the battle." And David said, "What have I done now? Is there not a cause? Father, speak to us in a language that we can understand. In Jesus' name, amen." Amen. This is an amazing story about a young man who had been brought from the backside of the wilderness to the front of national notoriety in a short time. I don't know about you, but I came to make an announcement that in this season that we are and in this congregation, somebody is going to be promoted from the backside to the front side miraculously. Maybe where you come from cannot be found on the most detailed map of Ghana. Nobody respects you. Nobody gives you a chance, but I have come here to make an announcement that God is about to give you a chance. You have cried enough. You have wondered, has God heard my prayer? I came with an announcement again that God heard your prayer before you began to pray. And there's going to be a performance. David showed up at the battlefront where Israel was facing a national challenge called Goliath. And for 40 days, Goliath was intimidating the armies of Yahweh. And David came on the scene and changed the situation. And when David came, he asked the question that what shall it be done for the man who takes on this giant? You see, before you commit to a battle, you must first know the rewards. I'm going to try it over here. I don't feel love here. Listen. I said, before you commit yourself to any fight, you must know the rewards. Because too many people get into fights that have no rewards. You fight some battles that after you finish, you don't even have strength to enjoy life. Listen, it is not every fight that you have to fight. Some of you, your only energy that you have is the energy to fight. There's a time to fight and there's not a time to fight. If you keep fighting, you don't have time to build. Are you hearing me? And when David got to know the reward, if the king says you are going to marry his daughter, surely you have to fight. So he fought. But out of this, I want to talk to you on what I've entitled Living a Distinguished Life. Because I realized that in my research, I found out that a lot of you are the young ones in this nation. And somebody has to speak into you and speak into your destiny. If you hear nothing from me at all and you remember nothing from me at all, if one day you can remember that a man was sent to this house and he spoke and he ignited some belief in me that I can become a distinguished citizen of this nation, I can go to my grave with joy. Listen to me, people of God. God never planned for your life to be ordinary. You were born to make an impact. You were born to leave a mark on your generation. When I say you were born to live a distinguished life, I'm not talking about just being famous, but I'm talking about being significant in this life, leaving your footprints in the sands of time. Because being famous can happen overnight. You can do something wrong, and overnight your face and everything can be in the newspapers. But when it comes to significance, it goes through a process. Listen, God has to process you for what he has processed for you. God has to prepare you for what he has prepared for you. And he will take you through some things. And I've come with an announcement that regardless of where you were conceived, regardless of who conceived you, and regardless of where you were born, you can still rise up of that place and make an impact on your generation. I think about a man called Moses, who was born at the wrong side of town. He was born into a system that was trying to kill him. And when he was born, his parents committed him into a basket and put him on a dangerous river. But the wind of the mercies of God began to direct that basket into the very place that he was going. Learn how, you see, we talk about free education, but God drove Moses to have free education in the palace that he will occupy one day. I've come to announce you, ladies and gentlemen, that the message of God will begin to blow upon somebody and it will begin to direct you. You may not understand why God is leading you the way he's leading you. You may not understand why you are going through what you are going through, but the eyes of God is directing your path, because the Bible says that there are many plans in a man's heart, but it is the counsel of the Lord that shall stand. You may not know where you are going, but God knows. You may not understand why you are going through what you are going through, but God understands. There is a reason for the madness that you are going through, the rejection, the pain, the hurts. There is a reason for that. And God is building your life for a reason, for a purpose. Some of you don't even understand why nobody is appreciating you, but when heaven appreciates you, it is something. Because let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, when a person promotes you, a person can demote you. When a person raises you, a person can put you down. When a person dresses you, a person can make you naked. But when God dresses you, nobody can make you naked. Are you hearing me today? God has a plan for your life. God took Moses out of nothing and made something out of him. Some of you are going through fire. It is for a reason and for a purpose. Listen, they tell me that fire destroys. Somebody told me, Pastor, fire destroys. And I said, yes, but it depends on what it meets. When fire meets paper, it destroys paper. But when fire meets gold, it brings out the best out of the gold. Whatever you are going through in life, the fires that you are walking through is to bring the gold out of you and make you the champion that God Almighty has ordained for you to be. Your value is not gone down because of the fire that you have been through, but your value is gone up because of the fire that you have been through. Many years ago, in one of the cities in America, in Florida, they painted a beautiful mural in the city center. They employed one of the best painters to paint that mural. It was very expensive. And he wrote his signature. You know, painters normally append their signatures to say, this is my handiwork. And one day there was a fire in the city. And the fire burnt a lot of things, including that beautiful painting. And the only place that was left was a small corner where the signature was. And they brought the insurance assessor to begin to assess the damage. And after he had assessed the damage, he looked at that little place that was left of that big painting with the signature. And he made an announcement. And he said, this little piece that is left now is more expensive than the whole thing. And people began to ask, why is that? Why is the reason? Why is it more expensive? And the insurance assessor said, the reason why that painting is more expensive than the rest is because of two things. Number one, because it survived a fire. And number two, the signature of the artist is still on it. I've come to tell somebody who has survived a fire that so long as the signature of God is still upon you, you are still here and your value is gone up. You have been through fire, you have been through water, but God is taking you to an expected end. High five somebody and tell the person you are going somewhere. Now be seated. Now we know. Am I doing okay so far? I'm not feeling the group over there. I don't know. Are you all depressed? Okay, then let your face show. Because I can't feel you at all. I can't feel up there. But listen to me. The story of David and Goliath is an interesting story. Israel was faced with a formidable challenge in the form of Goliath, a champion. The Philistines were mighty fighting machines, unequaled in their generation and time. They were sophisticated. The army alone was larger than the whole population of Israel. And look at the terms of the battle. Goliath said, bring me a champion. Somebody say champion. Listen to me, Spirit Life. God always has one champion for every church. Not two champions, not three champions, one champion. And in this house, your champion is Prophet Bernard. In a church where there are two champions, the church never grows. In a church where there are two champions, they don't go anywhere. There's infighting. And listen to what Goliath said. He said, you also bring me a champion and let's fight. If I kill your champion, you become you become our servant. And if he kills me, we will become your servant. Which means if you allow your champion, your prophet, your pastor to be taken by the enemy, you become slaves to that enemy. But listen, the time has come that we must understand to cover our champions, to protect our champions, to honor our champions, so that the world doesn't take our champions from us. What happened that day on that mountain between Israel and the Philistines and between David and Goliath is a picture of Calvary. On one side was Rome with their weapons, with their prestige, with their power, with their presence. On the other side was a carpenter's son who had nothing. They nailed him to a cross, but like David, he stood up after 3 days and he brought Rome to its knees. Out of that story, people of God, David saw an opportunity and he took it. May I say to somebody that life is full of opportunities? I said life is full of opportunities. But many times opportunities don't come to you screaming, I am an opportunity. Many times opportunities come to you as problems and crises. Problems are our opportunity. How do you know God as your healer when you don't have the problem of sickness? How do you know God has a friend that sticks closer than a brother when you have not betrayed before, been betrayed before? How do you know him as Jehovah my provider when your financial kingdom is not suffering violence? Whatever you are going through, whatever challenge or crisis, is an opportunity for God to show himself wonderful on your behalf. I tell you, where would David have been without Goliath? Where would Joshua be without the walls of Jericho? Anything that you are confronting today, if you will change your understanding and begin to look at this as an opportunity, God will use it to glorify his name in your life. Am I helping somebody? David saw the opportunity, and even though his brothers and Saul wanted to stop him, David refused to be stopped. Somebody say, I refuse.
I refuse.
Or say it one more time.
I refuse.
You see, many times we think that faith get, but sometimes faith also refuses. Your faith must learn to refuse something. Are you hearing me? Let me tell you something. It is not every food that is set before you that you must eat. I know you can't say amen. I'll try it here. I said, the fact that you are hungry doesn't mean you eat everything that is given to you. Because there's some food that you eat today, you pay tomorrow. You don't understand me. You understand me? You understand me when I'm gone home. Next week, you'll be walking the streets of Accra and say, ah. So when you come to church and you see somebody saying, ah, they suddenly understood what I was saying last week. Are you hearing me?
Yes.
I said this, it's not every food that is given to you that you eat. Especially, listen to me, some of you men. Every food you eat, every place you go, cook this for me, let me eat this. And now you don't understand why you have downloaded all kinds of things. Listen. Listen, me personally, I don't even trust people who can't fast. People who can't fast, I don't trust them. Because when you make them hungry, they'll begin to tell secrets. True or false? I just came to challenge you, but somebody say refused. Say refused. You must learn to, listen, life, breakthroughs in life is not always the things that you say yes to, but the things that you say no to. You must learn to say no to some things. Amen. Some of you can't say no. I'm going to give you an opportunity to say no. Are you hearing me? Because listen, do you know that there are some people who are dead today because they couldn't say no? Do you know there are some people who are in jail because they couldn't say no? Say no. Uh-huh. Some people got pregnant before their time because they couldn't say no. Some people married wrong because they couldn't say no. Say no. And listen, anytime you want to say no, people will trouble you. When people trouble you after you have said no, ask them, which part of no don't you understand? Because no is a complete sentence. No. And no means no. David said no to some things. And these are three things very quickly, and I'm going to step away. If you are going to live a distinguished life like David, if you're going to have a life that counts, number one, you must refuse to be intimidated to take your stand. Refuse any intimidation to take your stand. Because David refused to be intimidated by the giant. He refused to be intimidated by his brothers. He refused to be intimidated by the giant. He refused to be intimidated by his brothers. He refused to be intimidated by the king. Listen to me, people of God. You must learn to refuse intimidation. I know you are young, but so was David. David was about 17 years, probably younger than many of you, and yet he refused to be intimidated. He wanted to take a stand. He asked a question, is there not a cause? I may be young. I may not be a trained soldier. I may not be as tall as this giant. I may not have all the sophisticated weapons, but I refuse to be intimidated. Listen, if you are going to live a distinguished life, one of the major things that you have to deal with is intimidation from people. Listen, refuse to be intimidated. Because many people have been intimidated because they can't live a life that defies people's expectations. Intimidation will never go away. People will always try to intimidate you, and that intimidation is to control you. Sometimes people will intimidate you, ask you, do you know who I am? And listen, when you begin to let people intimidate you, you can never do anything. If you are intimidated by people today, I set you free from the spirit of intimidation. Some of you are intimidated about what people think about you. So you can't even be normal. You are always worried. So what are people thinking about me? Do you really want to know? If they really told you what they think about you, you would have moved to Bogatanga a long time ago. Are you hearing me? Tell somebody, be yourself. What is it about it that people can't be themselves in the church? Learn to be yourself. That is who God made you. No matter how you look, listen, you are okay. Listen, the Bible says we are wonderfully and fearfully made. That is why some people are wonderful and others are fearful. Which way you are, you fulfill scripture. So learn to like yourself. You wake up in the morning, look into the mirror and look at yourself and say, I like myself. Are you hearing me? Listen, what are you going to do if you rely on other people to make you feel good? If those people are not there, what are you going to do? When I wake up in the morning, I go to the mirror and I look at myself and I say to myself, Frankie, baby, you look nice. I mean, you are cool. And I walk with a swagger, you know. I have music on the inside of me. Wake up in the morning and walk with God Almighty. I say, wake up in the morning. Look. Dress, and look for places that people don't like you and go there and show yourself to them that I am still here. You cannot intimidate me. You cannot have any opinion, because listen to me, ladies and gentlemen of spiritual life, what people think about you is not as important as what God Almighty thinks about you. You are a royal priesthood, a chosen generation, God's own peculiar people. And so when you wake up in the morning, whether you feel like it or not, walk with a swagger, walk with a smile on your face. Know that the Most High God is your God. And who is it that speaks and it comes to pass when the Most High God has not commanded it? No man is your breakthrough. God alone is your breakthrough. You may not be there yet, but God will bring you. Refuse for people to put you down. Don't fear anything about what other people think about you. Listen, some of you are intimidated because people say all kinds of things about your background. Listen, everybody has a background. And the fact that your back is to the ground doesn't mean your back has to be on the ground forever. You can rise up and be the champion that God Almighty has ordained for you to be. There is championship on the inside of you, and it is time to let that champion come out. Some of you are worried about your past. Who doesn't have a past? Everybody has a past, but your past is only a past. There's going to be a brand new beginning for somebody. Let me tell you about something. Once upon a time, there was a man, and prophet. That man was a murderer. He had killed somebody and he had run away for 40 years. He was a runaway, a fugitive from Egyptian justice. But one day, as he was minding his business, thinking about his past that he thought had disqualified him, he saw a bush that was burning, that was not consumed. And when Moses turned aside, God said to Moses, take off your shoes, for the place that you stand is holy ground. But in all the conversation, God said, I am sending you back to the place that you failed in order to succeed. God is going to send somebody back to the place you failed to go and succeed. But listen to me, in all the conversation, God never referred to the past of Moses, because he saw something bigger than his past. He saw Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, the crossing of the Red Sea, the building of the ark for God. Oh, I think about a serial killer. He had killed so many people that he had lost count. And one day, he was going to kill some more people. And he met Jesus on the way to Damascus. And Jesus changed that man's life. Jesus did not reckon his past. But all that he said is that, Saul, I know there's something bigger on the inside of you. Resident on the inside of you is the letter to the Romans. On the inside of you is 1st and 2nd Corinthians. In the inside of you is Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, 1st and 2nd Timothy, Titus, and maybe Hebrew. I am telling you, there's something on the inside of you. Hey, my God. What is the highest denomination of money in Ghana? Who has a 50 CD note? Can I have one, please? Give me one. Give me one. Thank you. Thank you. I'll remember. But in case I forget, that's my gift. How much is this? You are lying. How much is this? Are you sure? Why? Is it 50? So if I go to buy something for 50 and I give them this, is it right? Are you sure? So this is valued 50. It's no trick. I say, is it valued at 50? So if I take this and I crumple it like this, how much is this? Oh, I don't believe you. But it's crumpled. Is this still 50? With all respect to Ghana, with all respect to Ghana. If I put this thing down and I step upon it like this, how much is it? Your life may have been crumpled. People may have stepped on you. But your value has not diminished. You are still worth your... Oh, God Almighty. I feel something. Is somebody hearing me? No matter what you have been through, so long as the blood of Jesus Christ has washed you and the Spirit of the Most High God is upon you, your worth is more than anything that you have been through. God richly bless you. God bless you. Secret millionaire for the future. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Listen, refuse to be intimidated to take your stand. Your greatest drawback in your journey may not be the sins you committed. Your greatest challenge is the life you refuse to live because of other people's opinion. You can be everything that God has ordained for you. Number two, let me do it quickly. Number one, refuse any intimidation to take a stand. Number two, refuse any intimidation by your critics. Refuse any intimidation by your critics. When David came to the war front, listen, his brother said, "You are insolent. You are a little boy. What do you think you have? Who do you think you are? Who did you leave the few sheep to?" They criticized him. Saul looked at him and said, "But you are just a small boy. You haven't been to war before. What can you do?" Listen, if you are going to do anything for God, if you are going to live a distinguished life, people are going to criticize you and they are going to accuse you. It's one thing you've got to understand. Criticism is the only worship that unachievers can give to achievers. Who criticizes a nobody? Who is a critic? A critic is somebody who is not like you, but wants to be like you and can never be like you. That is why they criticize and they backbite. One time somebody came to me and said, "Papa, I'm sad." And I said, "Why?" He said, "People are backbiting me." And I said, "That is good." He said, "Papa, you don't understand." I said, "They are backbiting me." I said, "That is good." He said, "Papa," I said, "they are backbite." I said, "What is the word again?" He said, "Backbite." And I said, "Not front bite, but backbite." Then when they are backbiting, it means they are at your back and they are biting your back, which means you are in the front. It is only people who are in the front that get backbiters. And the harder they bite you, the quicker you go in life. I pray to God Almighty that somebody will take the stones that people have thrown at you and use it to build a solid foundation for your life. Listen to me, people of God. Listen to me, spirit life. Listen, I tell people all the time that human beings, so long as they have a mouth, after they are finished eating, they will use it to talk. But you must come to that place that regardless of what they say, regardless of how much they criticize, you still believe in the God who still believes in you. Refuse to let anybody intimidate you by criticizing you. The strength of your dream is found in what it takes to discourage you. I have a question for you. How much does it take to stop you? Tell me something. How much does it take? Some of you give up too easily. Your middle name is quit. You quit. You give up too easily. How much does it take? Listen, life sometimes can throw the kitchen sink at you, but you must still be there. Prophet, I saw Saul the apostle. He was preaching. He went to a place called Lystra to preach. And they got him and they dragged him out of the city. And they stoned him and they killed him. They left him for dead. The disciples surrounded him. And they prayed for him and he was resuscitated. And in my mind's eye, I can see the apostle Paul. His bones were broken. His body was bleeding. And he dragged himself and came back to town and made an announcement that, hey, concerning the message I was preaching before you killed me, this is part two. I refuse to die. I said, I refuse for anybody to kill me. How much does it take to stop you? No matter what you do, I will come back. Listen, when they kill you today, tomorrow, rise up one more time. When they destroy you, rise up one more time. When they don't like you, dress up and go to where they don't like you and let them know that I am still here. Let them talk. Listen, as they are plotting, plan, as they are fighting, rise. As they are kicking you, go forward. Is somebody hearing me? He said that for this reason, we don't lose heart. For even though our outward man is perishing, our inward man is renewed day by day. For our light affliction, which works in us a far more exceeding an eternal weight of glory. Whilst we do not look at the things that are seen, for the things that we see are temporary. It means they are subject to change. They never came to stay. But the things that we don't see are eternal. I want to ask a question. How many of you have been accused before? I want to see your hand. How many of you have been criticized before? I want you to look at yourself and say, I am still here. Say, I am still here. Oh, I love a scripture. I love a scripture. You see, Jesus' disciples, when he was hanging on the cross, they thought it was all over for him. They saw with their two eyes that he was buried. And so they went back to fishing. But my Bible says in the book of John, chapter 21, that and Jesus showed himself again. After his resurrection, he showed himself again to his disciples. The people that didn't believe in him, he went and showed himself again. I am commanding you as an apostle of God that after church, go and use your Sunday dress to go and show yourself again to some people who thought it was over. Go and show yourself again. Sometimes I just dress up. I don't have anywhere to go, but I dress up looking for people who thought it was all over, and I just go and stand. I don't talk to them for to see that I am still here. Nobody can kill you before your time. Nobody can eliminate you before your time. It is impossible for you to die before your time. You are indestructible. You are unstoppable. Is somebody hearing me? I command every barrier in your mentality to come down now. Family devils, principalities and powers that have risen up against you, you will destroy them in the name of the Lord Jesus. You may be seated. You may be seated. Do you realize, man of God, David, he didn't waste his time trying to explain himself to his critics. Stop trying to explain yourself. You know why? Don't try to explain yourself to your enemies. You know why? I'll give you three reasons. Number one, your enemies will never believe you. No matter what you say, your enemies will never believe you. And number two, your friends don't need an explanation. But the biggest one why you shouldn't try to explain yourself is because you are not on trial. I don't have to explain myself to you because I'm not on trial. And besides, if I explain myself to you today, you meet me tomorrow, you still won't understand me because I am very, very unpredictable. The wind blows where it wants. Nobody knows where it's coming from, and nobody knows where it's going. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. When you are born of the Spirit, if they knew you on Tuesday and they think they still know you on Wednesday, no. Something has happened to you. Between last night and this morning, it's a long time for God to change Jacob from Jacob to Israel. Let me give you the last one. I'm beginning to finish. Now, you understand English, don't you? I am beginning to finish. I didn't say I finished. I am beginning to finish. So my beginning of the finish is longer than the beginning. So don't shoot your hopes at that he's going to sit down now. No. I stood up to be seen and I'm speaking to be heard. I'm beginning to finish. So finally, actually, Peter said finally in 1 Peter chapter 3, and he wrote two more chapters. So finally. So what is the first one? Refuse to be intimidated to take a stand. Number two, refuse to be intimidated by your critics and accusers. The final one is refuse to be intimidated by the size of what is in your hands. Refuse to be intimidated by the size of what is in your hands. If you continue on the story from verse 40 through 43, you realize that all that David had was just a slingshot, a catapult, and 5 stones. That is all that he had. And when you watch what Goliath had, Goliath was a formidable guy. He had some intimidating presence. When you look at it, look at what we read. He was dressed in armor, sophisticated armor. Coat of mail, you can't breach it. Swords and spears couldn't cut through. And he had an armor bearer too. The thing was, it was a no-brainer. It was a no contest. How do you use a knife to fight an American soldier who has an AK-44? AK-47. You are hopelessly outnumbered. But listen, in God, you are not outnumbered. You are not outgunned. You are not outmaneuvered. Are you hearing me? Because the little that you have, when God is upon it, he will do wonders. You didn't hear me. I said you didn't hear me. Listen, when God is in something, little is much. Because the God who called you is bigger than the call and the task and that little thing that is on your hand. Listen, whatever you have in your hand, David took these 5 smooth stones, small stones, and a slingshot. And that day, he solved a challenge that for 40 days had been troubling them. Let me tell you something. David took 5 stones. He didn't even have to use all the 5. He used the first stone. And I don't know about you. I didn't come for everybody in this room. I came for just you. And that you, listen. The first stone was the one that brought down Goliath. Some of you, you are the first stone in your family to bring down some challenges in your family. You are the first stone that will have a doctorate degree. You are the first stone that will break poverty in your family. You are the first stone that will break barrenness in your family. You are the first stone, ladies and gentlemen, that will do some things that people have never done before. Some of you, you are the first stone that will complete a building project in your family. Some of you, you are the first stone, ladies and gentlemen, that will buy a limousine in your family. Some of you are the first stone that will go abroad in your family. Somebody say, I am the first stone. They laugh at you. They talk about you. Why do you go to that church? Why do you go to that little church? God is preparing you as a first stone to do something in Ghana. There are some things that have never been done in Ghana. But could it be possible that Spirit Life will be the first stone in Ghana that will do things that people haven't done before? Sitting on the inside of you is a cathedral that has not come out yet. A state-of-the-art cathedral that shall be built in this nation debt-free. You never owe anybody to finish your building project. I am prophesying over you, man of God, that you raise up a cathedral in this nation, and people will look at it and look at you and say it is not possible. But you let them know that if it was possible, then God was not in it. For our God is the God of impossibility. He's able to do, and not only is he able to do, he's able to do exceedingly. Not only is he able to do exceedingly, but he's able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we ask and think, according to the power that is resident on the inside of us. God will take you as a first stone. You may come from a village in the Volta region, but you shall be the first stone that will bring light to your community. Some of you come from far away in northern region. You shall be the first stone that will build a skyscraper in the northern region of Ghana. Some of you are in your family and people are challenging you. They are taking you to Malams. They are taking you to all kinds of people. They want to stop you, but you are the first stone that will show them that the Most High God rules in the affairs of men. I say, somebody shout and say, I am the first stone. Now you may be seated. You are something. I say you are something. Listen. Let me finish. Not too long ago, I went to the store, George and Adeno, it's the Walmart near my home, to buy something. And I had my little boy with me, my youngest son with me. And he said, Daddy, may I have a basketball? Buy me a basketball. And I said, sure, son. So he went and I said, choose whichever one you want. So he chose one, and the price was $39.99, $40. Just $40 for that ball. And I began to think, as I saw him with that ball, that basketball in the hands of my son is only $40. If I took that same basketball and I placed it in the hands of Michael Jordan, it's a multi-million dollar basketball. If you gave me a golf club, that golf club in my hands is only a golf club. I don't even play golf. I may chase dogs with it. If you put that same golf club in the hands of Tiger Woods, it will bring millions of dollars home. Is somebody hearing me?
Oh, if you gave me a racket, I play tennis, I play. But if you put that racket in my hands, I am not a professional. It's not going to bring me any money. I play it for bodily exercise. If I take that same racket and I place it in the hands of Roger Federer, it's going to bring millions of dollars home. And I've come to announce to somebody that if you gave me some box of nails, I can only build a wooden box. If you gave only three of those nails to a Roman soldier and he began to use that nails in the hands of my Messiah, he shall become nails that will change the destiny of the whole world. If you gave me a dress, that dress is only a fashion statement. If you took that same dress and you put it upon the shoulders of Jesus, it shall become a healing instrument for a woman who had bled for 12 years and the bleeding was not stopping her. If you gave me 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, I can make a small party for my small family. Put that same 5 loaves and 2 fish in the hands of the master and he will do something with your life. I've come to announce to you, spirit life, that when you put your hands in the hands of Jesus, he will take your life and you make something great come out of your life. This is my story. This is my song. This is the word that God gave to me. God will make your life a distinguished life. Now sit down and listen. I don't know about you, but maybe this morning somebody invited you to church. Or you've come for a few times, but you've never given your life to Jesus Christ. Just as that basketball can be transformed from my son's hands into the hands of a genius and make a difference, in the same way, your life by itself will have no rhythm, will have no sync, will have no meaning until it falls into the hands of the master. There was an auction one day, and they were auctioning things. The last item to be auctioned was an old battered violin. The auctioneer lifted up the violin and said, "Who will bid for it?" One man looked at it. It's a waste of time. Who wants this old violin? So just to finish the auction and go home, one said, "I'll bid $1. Another man said, "I bid $2. Then a very high bid came in. Somebody said, $10. So it was hanging there for a long time. So the auctioneer took his gavel and said, "Go in, $10, go in." Then out of the crowd, somebody stood up. So everybody turned to look, and it was an old man. His back was bent. His hair was white. Walking in the wisdom and the dignity of years and experience. He came forward and stretched forth his hands and said, "Give me the violin." The auctioneer turned over that old wooden violin that somebody had valued for $10. And he took the bow and he dusted off the dust and began to play music. And out of that violin came an amazing song that everybody's jaws dropped like, wow. And when he had finished playing that masterpiece, he handed over the violin back to the auctioneer. And somebody said, "I want to bid for $10,000. Another said, and it went up and up. And somebody said, "I don't understand. So what made the difference?" And the auctioneer said, "It was because of the touch of the master's hand." Your life may be like that old violin, but when the hand of the master, the Lord Jesus Christ, touches you, your value will go up. And the only way it can be is when you give your life to the Lord Jesus. Is there anybody here today? You tell me, "Preacher, I want to give my life to the Lord Jesus Christ." I'm not talking about going to church. I'm talking about giving your life to the Lord Jesus. Is there anybody here who want to receive Jesus? God bless you. Another person? Anybody else? You don't feel shy. Anybody else? You want to give your life to the Lord? Let me tell you, man of God, the day I gave my life to the Lord Jesus, it was a Wednesday night, 1979. I gave my life to the Lord Jesus. I was the only person. I went to church to please a woman because she was troubling me too much. "Come to church, come to church." So I followed her. I didn't know I was making a mistake. So when the preacher preached, everything he said, I thought he was talking about me. So I was even angry that the woman had gone to set me up. I didn't know the Holy Spirit from Adam. And when he made the altar call, I thought everybody was going to stand up. So I stood up. And when I looked around, nobody was standing up. I was going to sit down. And the preacher said, no, come up, come. I made a bad mistake. And look at the mistake now. Look at this mistake. Don't you like this mistake? If this is God's mistake, then God make mistakes any day. Anybody else? For the touch of, I see another hand. God bless you. Anybody else? God bless you. Anybody else? Listen. Those of you who lifted up your hands, come to me very quickly. Let me pray for you. Come. Don't feel shy. Come. Let's make a mistake. Come. Let's make a mistake. I've never regretted it. The man of God, that day,
I gave my life to God alone. Now look at me. I've impacted thousands and thousands all over the world. Every Sunday, thousands tune in to listen to me. Many people from Saudi Arabia, Oman, I've never met them. I don't know where they come from. South Africa, Ghana, all over the world. Every Sunday, they listen because I made a mistake on Wednesday night. I want to pray with you. Okay? I want to pray with you. You are not standing here because I called you. You are standing here because Jesus has called you. Nobody can come to you and say his spirit brings him. I don't know what you have been through. And I can't promise you that tomorrow you'll be a millionaire. But I can promise you that from today, you begin to understand what life is all about. Okay? Pray this prayer with me. Pray this prayer with me. Say, dear Lord, I thank you that you love me. Today, I give my life to you. Lord Jesus, forgive me all my sins and make me your child. From today, I am all yours. In Jesus' name, amen. Father, thank you for this woman and these men. Pray that from today they will begin to walk in newness of life. Let them experience the power of your spirit and the wonder of your love. Let your good hand be upon them for good. I pray that out of today, their lives become lives of distinguishment. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Congratulations. God bless you. Congratulations. God bless you. Spirit life. I leave upon every one of you an irrevocable blessing. A blessing to rest upon your head that nobody can erase. From today, you will not sweat unnecessary to eat. You will not struggle to break through. You shall be a movement that will cause the world to take notice. For those who are looking for jobs, may God open doors for you. For those who are looking for opportunities to study, may God open doors for you. For those who want to travel, may God open doors for you. For those who are looking to marry, may God Almighty open doors for you. I set upon you an open heaven. And let it be said that God Almighty is with this house. So I have declared and so let it be. Agree with me and say amen. Man of God, thank you for the opportunity. I really, really appreciate you.